All right, so welcome back. And we are in the second part of our evening session. Well, it's evening in London, and it could be morning or afternoon, wherever you may be. And we're being joined by Robbie Stamp. And Robbie, there is quite a lot in your biography, and I didn't want to read it all out, but you're quite linked to the topic of resilience, because you are a fellow at the Resilience and Sustainable Development Program at Cambridge. And you're also the CEO of BIOS International, but you've had the most incredible career that I wouldn't know where to begin. So I wouldn't want to, it would just be injustice to just mention some of the stuff that you've done, but you've recently been on our podcast as well. And I will be sharing that podcast episode because it was absolutely phenomenal. But welcome, Robbie, it's over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Anna. Hello, everybody. So obviously I'm suddenly looking at somebody a great deal older. And just to say, with what Ben was just saying about resilience, I understand that so much. I'm nervous. I'm looking forward to this hugely. But, you know, although I've done a lot of public speaking, you know, I care always very much that I do a reasonable job, that people learn something, have some fun, something interesting. So it goes on. I mean, I don't know if that's good news or bad news. But it goes on, these things, messiness, wanting to get things right, getting things wrong. And I think the older I get, the more I feel that compassion for messiness that is a really, really important. So sort of just to build on those themes, I've been asked today to talk a little bit about artificial intelligence and our relationship with artificial intelligence. So I'm going to share my screen, I hope. I've just prepared a few slides. I hope it's not going to be death by PowerPoint. But here I am. This is me as a baby. So life, the universe, and everything, and a bit of AI obscured there by the window at the side there, and a bit of AI and a baby in a pile of leaves. And that's me. That's a sort of an awe moment. I'm going to sort of try and talk you through a couple of key thoughts. If there's one big thought I want to leave you with, it's the thought about being willing to think about different perspectives. And I'm going to start with a bit of a video, which is the beginning of a movie called The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. It's a movie written by a man called Douglas Adams, he wrote the books on which the movie was originally based. And I was very, very fortunate to have worked with Douglas. The video is about 3 minutes long, so just sit back and enjoy it. I hope again it's going to work. If it doesn't, don't worry, and I will I will vamp instead. I won't sing, I promise. It's got the lyrics, because I want you to pay attention to the lyrics and some of what's being said. So I am going to share this. Here we go. And there we go.
It's an important and popular fact that things are not always what they seem. For instance, on the planet Earth, man had always assumed that he was the most intelligent species occupying the planet, instead of the third most intelligent. The second most intelligent creatures were, of course, dolphins, who, curiously enough, had long known of the impending destruction of the planet Earth. They'd made many attempts to alert mankind to the danger, but most of their communications were misinterpreted as amusing attempts to punch footballs or whistle for tidbits. So they eventually decided they would leave Earth by their own means. The last ever dolphin message was misinterpreted as a surprisingly sophisticated attempt to do a double backward somersault through a hoop while whistling the Star Spangled Banner. But in fact, the message was this: so long, and thanks for all the fish.
So sad that should come to this. We tried to warn you all, but oh dear. You may not share our intellect, which might explain your disrespect for all the natural wonders that grow around you. Swamps, along and lakes, for all the fish.
The world's about to be destroyed. There's no point getting all annoyed.
Lie back and let the planet dissolve. Like those nets of tuna fleets, we thought that most of you were sweet, especially tiny tops of your pregnant women. So long, so long, so long, so long, so long.
Right. So what I wanted to focus on there was the first phrase as well. Things are not always what they seem. And that, as a lot of you, as I heard say, you're interested in the ethics of AI, sustainable development goals, some of the massive challenges that your generation faces. And I trained a long time ago as an historian. And it's always interesting. If you look at going back in history, you can always look at societies when people felt that they were facing massive changes and that, you know, the world was, as everybody knew, it was changing. I do genuinely think there are some very, very good arguments to be made for the 21st century, this era we're heading into because of climate change, because of AI, because of a range of things, that there's something unique going on. And there's something unique going on, and my focus is going to be on the relationship between your human embodied selves, ourselves, the self that's sitting on a chair, feeling the air, feeling excited, feeling thrilled, feeling who is this person talking to me, tired at the end of the day, energized at the end of the day. Your dreamtime imaginative self, that's yourself in those stranger moments of daydreaming, the space between sleep and waking, those other thoughts, your poetic self, and your digital selves. And that relationship is going to be, I think, one of the defining relationships of the 21st century. And AI has obviously got an absolutely critical role and space to play in all that. So I was very lucky. I knew Douglas Adams very well. I was an executive producer on that movie. And Douglas Adams was a wonderful man. He was a big 6'5", very huggy, immensely good company. He was immensely enjoyable to hang out with and just great at conversation. Very thoughtful, very kind. The night my father died, he called. He'd been very kind and thoughtful as my father got ill. And then we talked into the night as we often did. And then the very next day, Douglas died. He died very young. He was only 49 years old when he died. And I miss him still. He was one of those people who was truly touched with genius. And he used to tell this wonderful parable. He told the parable of a puddle. And it's about perspective. And he said, there's this puddle. And it wakes up one morning. And it looks around at the hole that it's in. And the puddle thinks to itself, this hole fits me very neatly. In fact, this hole that I'm in fits me so neatly, it must have been made especially for me. And the puddle continues to believe that the hole that it's in was made especially for it as the sun comes up and the puddle evaporates. And I think that was Douglas's plea for a little bit more humility on behalf of sapiens in believing that we are the apogee of cognition, perception, and intelligence around which the whole universe revolves. So I think the great challenge for our generation, still, I've got a few years left in me, but certainly for yours, is how you're going to hold the balance between caring deeply about humanity and getting over ourselves at the same time. How do we do that with a bit more humility? And how do we all learn to be better ancestors? That simple phrase of all the kind of challenge and work that you all want to do, which is wanting to solve big problems, wanting to solve small problems, problems which will affect directly a local community. But I offer you a framing for thinking about the way of doing that, which is be a good ancestor, because there are people all over the world from indigenous communities who've always thought hard and carefully about what it means to make policy, make decisions, create technologies with a much wider sense of responsibility for the animals, for planets, for other systems. So that puddle parable, I think, matters hugely, and it's a nice frame, and that be a good ancestor. And if you like, be a good ancestor for me is the opposite of all the storm and trouble we see in the world as the species, all of us of all ages, respond to the challenges we face with a thought about build a wall and blame other people. And in a lot of countries still hark back to a golden age when it was all better, which in a lot of places means, wasn't it all better when it was all white middle-aged men? And I think that's a tragedy. And I think that the movement of be a good ancestor allows everybody to think from, you know, you can have a little pollinator on your windowsill for bees and pollinators, or you can want to do something really, really big with cryptocurrency or a really important piece of technology around climate change or batteries or something which helps a local community to come together. So that be a good ancestor framing, within that context, how do we start to think about artificial intelligence? I'm going to share my screen again, I hope, just briefly, because I didn't want to make it all PowerPoints. But let me see if I can. So Douglas Adams, there he wrote a number of books, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, Last Chance to See. Last Chance to See is a wonderful book about animals that are disappearing, very sad, and animals that were in danger of going extinct. One of the brilliant insights, for example, Douglas had there was about rhinoceroses, who've got a phenomenal sense of smell. And therefore, his insight is, in a way, their perspective, the way they are, the way they be in the world, is to exist in some kind of three-dimensional smellscape, where what matters to them is smells that are very fresh, smells that are old. So in a way, they're seeing in time through their smells and the way they smell in their environment. I think that's a really interesting example of perspective. So there's a great man himself, lovely man, 6'5". That was a picture we took at the offices that I had with him. One of his great creations is this character called Marvin, the paranoid android. And I'm going to juxtapose Marvin the paranoid android and this creature, Littlefoot. Now, I'm very lucky. I'm on the advisory board of a foundation in South Africa which curates some of the earliest hominin remains on the planet. And this is one of the oldest. She's called Littlefoot. She's 3.67 million years old. 3.67 million years old. She was found in caves in South Africa, about 45 minutes northwest of Johannesburg. And she's an astonishing 98% complete. And she's one of our shared ancestors, all of us, every single one of us on the call. We all came out of Africa. And so I think, again, in that be a good ancestor phrasing, how do we do more to understand our shared origins, celebrate diversity, and be better stewards in the name of Littlefoot? And then as we start to think about the way in which AI is going to enable us to solve some phenomenally complex and difficult challenges and problems as we move into the future, as we have this new manifestation of something new in the world. One of the things I want to do is to move the argument on from people who will tell you that AI is just maths, just data. It's true, but it doesn't go far enough to start to understand what the relationship between embodied human beings, with all of our mystery and our capacity to feel pain and joy, and this ontology is. Let's take an example of a word like tool. And I have debates about this. I'm not saying I'm right by any means, but I debate on this. If you use the word tool to describe a hammer and a global algorithmic trading system, which buys and sells shares in fractions of seconds without asking any human beings, if you use the same word to describe a hammer and a global algorithmic trading system, I'm not convinced you're saying anything very useful about describing the way in which that algorithmic trading system, that AI, is present in the world. And so I'm going to invite you to a long-running thought experiment in your own heads, which anybody can do, which is to think of three categories of words. Words that you can use to describe what AI is, what it does, how it sits in relationship to us. Words which you go, we can have a conversation about that, and words which I think you really can't. And in the remaining time, I'm going to give you some examples of what I mean by each of those three things. And then mindful of time and your time, and that you've I'm sure you will have all have had long days already in your different time zones. If anybody's got any, I will be happy to take some questions. So let's use a word. Let's imagine a word like authority. Now, I'm going to preface this by dealing with one objection to this kind of thought experiment, which is what's meant to be the sin of anthropomorphizing, giving things human characteristics. And I want to suggest that maybe anthropomorphization is a sin, but for a different reason, and it's to do with the puddle. And it's, again, to get over ourselves and thinking that we are the only thing, person, peoplehood, which is capable of being certain things or feeling certain things or relating to others in certain ways. So let's take a word like authority, a really important word. And let's imagine that three of you are working in a company where your job has been to read curriculum vitae, people's CVs for jobs. They're applying to companies for jobs. And Eleanor is your boss, and she has given you the authority to decide, as you read through the interviews, who comes in for a job interview and who doesn't. Now, I'm not talking about all the issues around bias and things at the moment, because I expect you'll do a lot of that. I want to stay focused on this word, the use of this word. So I would argue that in that sense, Eleanor has delegated authority to you. She said, you decide who comes in for interview and who doesn't. Now, if you get an AI system to do precisely the same work, my argument would be not only should you use the word authority, but you must, because otherwise you are not clear about in that moment the relationship between the work the AI system is doing and all these people applying for jobs. Because in that moment, the AI system is wielding a similar enough form of authority to you as people are. So I think a word like authority fits into that first category, that you can use that word without breaking its meaning. Second category, words where you go, let's have a think about that. And I'm going to use the word empathy. So imagine any one of you coming home, I don't really mind what it is. Let's say it's 15 years down the road. And you come home and there's a pretty decent Android, human looking robot in your house by that stage. And it says to one of you, I'll pick one name, just Freddy there on the screen. And it says to Freddy, Freddy, how was your day? And Freddy says, oh, it was a really difficult day. I had a really hard meeting, a project I've been working on for a long time. Yeah, I know, says the AI. I tell you what, Freddy, go and make yourself a cup of tea. pour yourself a glass of wine, whether you drink, if you drink, if you don't, have a cup of tea, a glass of mint tea, come back and tell me about it. And your body starts to secrete the hormones you might. If a friend or a partner or a parent was saying to you, sweetheart, how was your day? How did it go? Here's the question. Are you being empathized with? Is the AI system being empathetic? And does the difference matter? Now, I run a number of webinars where people talk about these kind of things. Recently in a group, what people thought was, oh, yes, okay. Yeah, I'm being empathized with, but it isn't being empathetic because it doesn't feel in its tummy the way you would if you cared about a friend who came to you and said, look, I've had a really bad day. I've had a tough day at school, fell out with friends, something, a problem in a friendship group. Doesn't feel that in its tummy. But one of my friends in the group, who is a very high functioning autistic person, said, well, I don't really feel empathy. I've taught myself to spot the signs when empathy is expected of me, but I don't really feel it. So am I not being empathetic in that moment? So there's that second category of words, which gets really interesting. We ran a webinar recently where people were asked, could an AI system be angry with you? Could it be angry with you? And inquiring into the relationship space like that with these words is very interesting in terms of understanding what our emerging relationship is going to be, what that liminal space, and just that liminal space is space where things are emerging, which haven't quite formed yet. Now, the third category of word is words which I think it's really dangerous to use. And I'll think about a word like accountability. I think AI cannot be accountable. So whenever you hear the phrase AI accountability, I would always suggest to somebody else, reverse it, accountability for AI. And here's my reason. You can't sanction or punish an AI. So again, let's imagine if a driverless car knocks over a child. Somebody may be liable for it. There may be insurances, but the AI on the car doesn't feel anything. If I were to do the same thing, if I were to have had just one glass of wine too many and knock over a child, and I would be caught, I would be tried, and I would be sent to prison, I would lose my liberty, I'd come out. But maybe the other thing happens for the whole of the rest of my life. I wake up in the middle of the night with a nightmare of remembering that moment where I hit that child. I'm filled with guilt and remorse, pain for the rest of my life. And there's no ethical system we've yet created where some form of meaningful sanction for transgression, which does involve pain, either banishment or in some societies still physical pain. I'm not advocating that, just saying that's the reality. And so I think you can't be accountable if you can't be sanctioned. And that's a really important distinction. All those other things about, let's think about all the categories for each and every one of us, which make us human. Joy, love, the pain of unrequited love, loss, bereavement, happiness, whole swathes of our humanity. And I'm going to finish by relaying a little anecdote. I was on a webinar the other day and somebody started to talk about, it was being run by a woman who's written a very important paper recently about big language models and some of the dangers about bias and things in these big language models. And this man started to say, but humans are algorithms, we're just maths. And she shut him down. She said, I will no longer engage with people who deny my humanity. And he flinched. It was a really interesting moment. I would say every single one of you, as we think about some of the claims that are made by data scientists, either they seek to say it's just maths, it's just applied maths. And I hope I've gone through enough reasons why the relationship matters. And you've got to explore and understand the relationship between AI and us and animals and plants and the atmosphere. And then all the things which make us human are messiness, our capacity for things that are deeply constructive and deeply destructive. All of those things, don't let anybody ever deny your humanity at any stage of your lives, no matter what the other claims made for AI one day knowing everything that we've ever known. In the question and answer, if anybody's interested, I could go a little bit further on why I think those claims that are made, some of the bigger claims made around AI, are nonsense. I will stop there. And Eleanor, if there are any questions, then I'm happy to take them. If you've got any, then fire them my way.
Brilliant. Well, I have got a surprise for you, and I'm hoping she's still here. Yes, she is. So I brought Michaela.
Oh, fantastic. How wonderful.
Michaela, to think of some questions to ask you, because I think she's used to asking you questions. Michaela, how are you? Come and join us.
I'm great. Thank you for inviting me.
Hi, Michaela.
I actually just invited her when the talk started. I'm like, oh, I've got Michaela on the call.
Fantastic.
And I invited her. So she didn't realize, she didn't know you were actually doing a talk, but I know you've already had an interaction previously.
This would have been some familiar ground then for Michaela.
Exactly. I know you always have questions for Robbie. What would be the first questions you would want to ask Michaela?
Well, yeah, as usual, I have a lot of questions, but this was something, Robbie, that I hadn't really ever discussed with you before, heard you talk about, and it was the point you made about kind of looking at the neurotypical versus the neurodivergent perspective when we're comparing it to AI. And yeah. I was wondering if you could kind of elaborate on some of the implications of the fact that quite often we compare, you know, and use a benchmark of a kind of neurotypical way of dealing with emotions and interactions as the benchmark for AI. But actually, you touched on quite an interesting point about, you know, neurodivergent perspectives and what that could mean for the implications of these emotions. So can you kind of elaborate on that a bit?
Yes, I mean, I think it was a moment in that webinar which brought everybody up short, because it was interesting for both the reasons of, well, thinking more deeply about AI, and then more deeply about people. And I think, if you like, I think one of the wider points there is so much AI has been based on the way in which a certain kind of group of people, very often white male engineers, have thought about the world. So the way they've constructed things, what they think is being a typical kind of person, the responses that they expect to see, what it means to know and have kinds of, what forms of knowledge they respect and acknowledge, I think is a really, it's dangerous. And I think you can even see, that's why my point about not denying your humanity, each and every single one of us on this call is an irreducible mystery. There are things about us which are always unknowable. And in that beauty of neurodiversity, to suggest that there's a form of AI, as some people call it, the singularity, which one day kind of hits a motherload of all knowing. Well, who's knowing? I mean, and what is it? What does that even begin to mean? I mean, for each and every one of us on the call today, there would have been different responses to what is being said. It would have triggered different memories. Different things would have been going on in your brain, in your mind. Some of it will have landed. Some of it won't. Some of it will have gone, whoa, what the heck did he just say? Because it was quite dense. But you will have laid down in your mind, and between us, the people here who've shared this moment, something unique has just been laid down, something undigitizable, forever undigitizable. So in a way, the neurodiversity piece is another example of the way we can claim the humanity part of us, but that's not to do the work about trying to inquire into, well, what is AI? How is it manifest? How is it present in the world? And what's our relationship with it going to be?
Great, thank you. That was really interesting.
Do you have any more questions, Michaela? Does anyone else have any questions?
I always have more, but I feel bad kind of jumping in. bombarding. So I'll let someone else have a turn.
Let's see. There are no more questions from the chat room. Anyone else? Don't be shy. And you won't have a chance to ask Robbie questions live just like that. I mean, Robbie is very approachable and you can definitely connect with him on LinkedIn if you are on LinkedIn.
Absolutely. Very, very, very much so. Please do. If there's, you know, anything there that, you know, you want elucidated or added to, I'm always only too happy to. Because I do think that, you know, your generation has got, I think in a way, if what are the messages? It's about, as you do this work with AI and data and program, just make sure that you always claim your humanity and don't think deeply about what it means to know anything. And Michaela knows this is one of my obsessions, is what does it mean to know anything? If you think about the way you know yourself at the moment, we have an interior conversation sometimes with ourselves about who we are, what we are. Oh, I wasn't very kind then, I got that right, I didn't get that right, I'm upset, why am I upset, why am I happy? If you believe in a God, then you'll feel that your God knows you. Your God knows about you. You would maybe feel that you're known by your friends, your family, your mother, your father, your uncles, your aunts. They know you. They know the things you like. They'll know when you get upset. And now there's a whole new space emerging, which, if you think about what it means to be in data space, we're not these comforting digital, comfortable digital twins. It's not that there's me and a digital twin. There's something else going on where we are splintered in data space, consistently being formed and reformed in data space. And it's really important because that's about power. Who wields the power? In whose interests are these systems created? Who have you thought about in terms of how it might harm? Who's in the room when the systems are designed? How do you consistently ask, how are things working? If you think about AI ethics and governance, I've kind of got three questions. You set a system in motion, and then you want to ask, how's that working for us? And of course, that, you know, what's the that? What do you mean by working? Critically, who do we mean by us? Who do we mean by us in this context? Because for a long time, that us, if we make it a big issue, if you'd asked a bunch again, I'm, you know, not being overly self-flagellating, but, you know, white middle-aged men in powerful Western societies, how's that working for us? They'd have gone, great, gangbusters. I'm making shed loads of money. I've got the power. I've got the cars, the two cars. It's great. Thank you very much. How's that working for us? Great. So who do you mean by us? How wide is that us? I think there's a good book to be written called The Narrow Us. What has been such a narrow us? And then critically, the third question is, of whom are you asking those first two questions? How active are you being in going and getting the answers to those first two questions about how's that working and who do you mean by us? And now you've got AI. Now you've got another thing you can ask, which is, of whom or what are you asking? Just think about those three questions always if you're designing things. Who's it intended to work for? Who's been involved in the design? How widely have you cast your thought about the harms? Who do you mean by us? And then the governance piece, which is so often overlooked, is how do you continue to track? Well, how is that going for us? Did it work? Did it do what we intended it to do? Is it creating more harm than good? And here's another thought for you around unintended consequence. What you want to do is you want to do the work, which is, I'm not going to swear, but I registered a domain recently, which is called firstyellowsticky.com. And firstyellowsticky.com came about because I was so enraged by the performance of somebody here in the UK in front of a parliamentary select committee when she came on in a select committee and claimed that nobody could foresee some of the problems when children went back to school last autumn with fear of COVID. And I thought, what? If you'd got eight teachers together and asked them what happens at the beginning of term, one of the first yellow stickies on the wall would have been people come back with sniffles. So what's everybody going to be frightened about? So firstyellowsticky.com, don't not do the hard work at the beginning and don't overlook the obvious. But then critically, how do you be with emergence? How do you track the things that you didn't expect to happen? So there's a phrase you will hear again and again and again about unintended consequences. The point about unintended consequences is that you didn't mean it to happen, but the phrase can be meaningless. Because what it's meant to say is we wanted to foresee all eventualities. You can't, you won't. You will foresee some, and then stuff happens. The key thing in it is how much you track stuff happening. And that goes back to my three questions, which is, who do you mean by us, and who are you asking? What are your sense-making mechanisms for understanding what's going on? So when you think about ethical AI, when you think about sustainable and responsible innovation, these are really good questions to hold in your mind.
Fantastic. Well, Robbie, this is a brilliant way to kick off our sort of ethics series of talks, or ethical series. And there will be many more. So tomorrow we will have Zoe from the Reuters Foundation talking about surveillance and politics and power. And I think this feeds really, really well into some of the discussions that we will be having this week and next week as well. So we have a whole course, ethics course that was developed by Quantum Black. And we will be diving into 5 days of this next week as well. So fantastic. I definitely would love to have you back, because there is just so much there is so much to discuss. There is so much to highlight within the AI ethics space. And this is only day two, everyone. So
one piece of advice then, as you navigate it, think about words. In whatever language is your natural language, think about the precision of language. Is it meaningful to apply it to AI or our relationship with AI? That can be a guiding thing through everything else you're going to hear. That precision is a good guide. And I thank you so much for inviting me on. I appreciate it very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us. So everyone, we will be closing today on this high note. Thank you, Freddie, as well. So everyone, do please react, because it's very difficult to see your faces and know what you're thinking right now. But do share and tweet and react to Robbie with emojis or some emotions in here to show him what you think and whether you appreciate everything he's just spoken about. There you go, lots of hearts
being hearts, sent heart, hearts, embodied hearts. And again, just, I'll give you that thing. It means something to me.
Those
hearts, in a way that it would never mean anything to an AI, except in I got some hearts in a data space. But I'm sitting looking across some nice fields. It's raining. I was looking forward to this. I've had a nice time. Those hearts, deeply meaningful. And that's what I mean about don't let anybody ever deny your humanity in the face of all this data and data science.
Exactly. This is such an important point to end day two. So please, a lot of things to reflect on, and we will be posting things in Discord. Robbie, if there is anything you would like to follow up with me on, what we should be reading, or any articles or anything else to reinforce your messages, please send them to me by email, and I will post them in Discord and add them into our resources. Mm-hmm. And guys, if you go into podcast, Teens and AI podcast, you will be able to listen to an episode with Robbie that was curated by Michaela. She was the host with Adia. So it's a fantastic episode, and you will hear many more of this incredible philosophical thought on AI and ethics and Hitchhiker's Guide and everything else. It's been really fascinating having you, Robbie, as always. We'll have you back next year, if not earlier, I promise you.
Thank you.
Everyone, and have an amazing evening. So we'll be back here every day at 5 o'clock to do our self-development sessions, as well as listening to other incredible, inspiring speakers like Robbie. So have an amazing day, everyone. I'll see you guys all in Discord. Bye, everyone. Bye, Robbie. Thank you.